Okay. So last time we introduced buoyancy and Archimedes Principle. So today, hope to review that and discuss how you can use it. Now what? Apply it in your everyday lives. So we'll check out some things that are sinking and floating. Whether in water or in air. Because remember, fluids are water, and liquids and gases. And hopefully today's lecture will put more of the pieces together, so when you're looking at the homework, it'll make more sense. Your homework on chapters 13 and 14, 13's on liquids, 14's on atmospheric pressure, is due Sunday. I should get through them enough by the end of this week, so you'll be okay. Some of you have gotten ahead because, you know, you didn't have to have anything to do last Sunday, right? Okay. So let's make something float. Some water. Here's a ball. Boink. All right, what are the forces acting on that ball? Gravity. Good, good. So let's draw that. All right, it still has mass. Oh. So it still has a weight, mass times gravity. Good. Are there any others? Buoyant force, yes, this new one. All right. Which direction? All directions the water is touching it.
It's not just pushing it straight up. Anywhere where the water is touching it, it's pushing it in straight.
Good. Very good. We did that. The animation last time where you had a block. And pressure is depth dependent. So the pressure is larger here, than it is there. Because this has more water on top of it. And the same over here. But these are at the same depth. These are at the same depth. These are at the same depth. So they kind of negate each other because they're pushing in on it. But they're there. The bottom is deeper. So it's a little more than even these. And the top should be the least, right? There is a net difference. This pressure is due to just the weight of the water acting on it. So the buoyant force is created by this difference. It's one way to look at it. It's kind of like the net effect. It is adding up all of those forces. And what you end up with is this one minus these. And we call that the buoyant force. So I'm glad you remember that, yeah, all of these pressures are acting on it, or all these forces because of the pressure acting on the various areas. The end result, though, so we don't have to do all these little ones every time, is that there's only an upward force acting on this due to all of this. Does that make sense? That's what we call the buoyant force. Again, when you're in a swimming pool, or you see the ball, it's clearly got something pushing up on it. All of that was to clarify. Bless you. So there's an upward buoyant force on this. There's lots of forces on it, but we're not going to draw those every time. Now, how do you think the magnitudes of these compare? Is the ball going up? Is the ball moving up right now? Is it moving down?
No,
That's right, Stephen. This net force. And it's the two forces. You got weight down. And if we say that's negative, then the buoyant force is positive. It's the difference between those two. If it's not moving anywhere, the net force is zero. Those are equal. It's balanced right now because it's not moving up or down. We've been doing that all semester. So it's floating there on the top like that. Those are the two forces. What happens if I push it underwater? What's it want to do? Yeah. Start at the bottom. Think I can make it clear? Almost. What if I get a twist? Hey! Yeah, it's a messy lab. So why does it want to come back up when it's underwater? Because the force pushing the ball is what?
That force is pulling the ball.
Well, it pushes, what force?
The water.
The water, yeah. We now call, have a name for that. The force the water acts on the ball is called the buoyant force. So yeah, the buoyant force is more. In that case, we have, it's more like this. Did we change its weight? No, the ball is still the same mass, so it has the same weight. But the buoyant force is bigger. So now there is a net force, and it accelerates upward. It rises to the top. Why is this bigger?
Is it because the ball is less dense in the water?
Because it's less dense in the water. That's logical. Let's see, though. What would make it change its density? From here to here. It might. I'm just seeing. Let's see. Are we changing the mass? We can check. Density is the ratio of mass to volume. Did we change the mass from here to here? Did we change the volume? We changed its position. That's true. So we haven't changed its density. Do you see that? But what'd you say, Eddie?
It's displacing more water.
It's displacing more water. So? Good. I was hoping somebody would remember that. It's displacing more water. Do you see more volumes under the water? Up here, only this much is underwater. And it was one of the last things. But that's why you guys have the book to learn more too, you know. Archimedes Principle. Archimedes Principle. That was what I was trying to do with that scale and the object hanging down and then when it was floating. Archimedes' principle is that the buoyant force is equal to the weight of the displaced water. Weight of displaced water. And generically, fluid, because this works for any fluid. So if it displaces more water, the buoyant force is larger. If more of it's underwater, it's displacing more water, that water weighs more, the buoyant force is larger. So it rises up whoosh, until not all of it's submerged. How does it know how much to be underwater? Well, until the weight of that displaced water equals the weight of the whole object. When the buoyant force equals the object's weight, then it stops moving. Do you see that? This buoyant force is proportional. It's exactly equal to the weight of that displaced water. So you have to look at how much water is being displaced, the volume of the object underwater. Yeah?
So assuming we don't have a sphere, we have a very flat object.
Uh-huh. How high it's going to be above the water and how much underneath will depend on its weight and its density. Because what if we took this ball and scrunched it? Let's do that. I got one for that. Here's a paper boat. I made two of them. I don't know if we need two. Let's see. So it floats, and almost hardly any of it underwater. It's because it's light. Its weight's not much, so it doesn't need much buoyant force to counter it. So it only needs to displace a little bit of water. But if I, you know, it's just a piece of paper. If I crumple it up, have I changed the density of the boat? How about the paper? Have I changed the density of the paper? No, paper's paper. But I have changed the density of the boat. It's now, it's the same mass, but it takes up less space. Did I increase or decrease the density? Increased. More mass. I mean, same mass, sorry. Same mass in less space. Will it float or sink now? Still floats. But look, it floats underneath more, doesn't it? Why? Because it's more dense. It has the same weight. But density can affect whether it sinks or floats also. Let's go. I need to make it more dense, right? Sink or float? Now it sinks. We've increased the density enough that it sinks. So another, there's two ways to look at sinking and floating. I'm going to make a little chart for you. One, forces. If these are equal, the thing doesn't move. You should know that by now. It doesn't accelerate. There's no net force. If this is bigger, it's going to start coming up. If the weight is bigger, it's going to sink until it equalizes at the top or rests on the bottom. We can also look at it with density. If the density of the object is greater than the density of the fluid, you just saw what happens. If the density of the boat increases enough so that it's greater than the density of the water it was around, it sinks. That's the case when the buoyant force is not enough to counter the weight. The weight's winning. Down is bigger than up, so it goes down, it sinks. And that means the density of that object is larger than the density of the fluid it's in. We sink in the fluid of our atmosphere, right? We're more dense than the surrounding air, so we sink. What's something that doesn't sink in the atmosphere? Helium. A helium balloon is the other way around. Its density is less than the density of the fluid. The density of helium is less than the density of air. So it floats. It goes up. And that's the same as if the buoyant force is larger than its weight. A helium balloon doesn't weigh that much. So a bit of buoyant force can overcome its weight and make it rise up. We put helium in a balloon. That balloon displaces the air. The weight of that displaced air, by Archimedes' principle, is the buoyant force. Can be displaced water or displaced air. And what if they're equal? What happens? What happens? Yeah, it would be outside forces. What if there's no outside forces? What would happen? We'd be in equilibrium. See, remember the term. Would it move? No, it'd stay put. Neither. It doesn't sink. It doesn't float. For things like this, we call it neutrally buoyant. Neutrally buoyant. It doesn't sink. It doesn't float. Fish can do that. They stay underwater, right? And they can stay put. They're not sinking. They're not floating. They're not rising up. They're just staying put. They're neutrally buoyant. At that point, their density is the same as the water. Their weight is balanced by their buoyant force. They're displacing enough water to counter their weight. Submarines do that too. They can just hover down there, right? You know, go home, fill a Ziploc bag full of water. Put that bag in water. Do you think it'll sink or float? Depends on how much air you got in the bag. If it's all water inside, no air, the whole bag is essentially water. There's very little plastic. You should see it kind of neutrally float in there. It'll move a little bit. Yeah?
Why is the water pushing up? Why is that?
Because pressure is depth dependent. It's pushing on you everywhere, but the part of the object that's farther down is feeling more pressure than that that's higher up. And that slight little difference, even if it's this skinny, there is a difference, provides the buoyant force upwards.
So like there's a buoyant force for air then?
Yeah, air has a buoyant force. There's a buoyant force on you right now. You're displacing a certain amount of air. If we could take the amount of air you displaced and weigh it, it wouldn't weigh that much, would it? Because air is light. But it would weigh something. That's the buoyant force buoying you up even as we speak. So if you're standing on a bathroom scale, right, and you weigh 180 pounds, okay, what are the forces acting on you when you're standing on a scale? We've just added one. You got the weight, and you got the scale pushing back up on you, right? The normal force. We've said those are balanced. We now know about another force that's going on. It is the air causing a buoyant force. In which direction? Up. There's a small buoyant force on us because we're displacing a fluid of air. So what if we got rid of the air right now? You're standing on the scale and you remove the air. Poof, the air is gone. Will you weigh more or less? Yeah, you'd weigh more. See here, the air is helping buoy you up a little. You get rid of that, and the scale will increase to compensate. It's like you weigh more. If that doesn't make sense, the analogy is jumping in a swimming pool, you feel lighter, it's because it's buoying you up. Good question. Very interesting question. If you went higher in the atmosphere, you'd weigh less because... You'd weigh more? Because there's less atmosphere buoying you up. For that reason alone, absolutely. If you go up higher and higher, there's less air you're displacing. So the buoyant force on you would be less as you go higher up, which means you would weigh more. Something else interesting happens, though, when you go higher up in the atmosphere. There's less air. As you just said, it's less dense. So the density changes also. And that can change the ball game too. So there's more than one thing happening. A weather balloon is like that, right? They make them nice and big. You ever seen one of those weather balloons? They're huge. It's because they need to displace enough of the fluid of air to get a big enough buoyant force to counter its weight, so that it can rise up. As it goes up in the atmosphere, think what happens. There's less air. It's less dense. So there's less pressure on it. Yeah. So the buoyant force decreases because there's less air it's displacing. So it shouldn't go up. It should fall at some point or stay put. But also, Because there's less pressure, yeah, the balloon expands. Because the air in here, or helium, is trapped. It's at a certain pressure. As you go up in the atmosphere, this pressure changes and it drops. As this gets smaller, this one wins out. The difference expands the balloon. If the balloon expands, what happens to its buoyant force? It goes up because it's displacing more fluid. So two things are happening. The density out here, the density is decreasing as you go up higher. If this decreases enough that this is greater than this, it would sink. But the pressure changes too. This pressure stays the same, this decreases, which makes it expand to increase the buoyant force. When it expands, it adjusts its density also. This might make more sense to most of you taking something underwater. If you were to take a balloon and put it under the water and just keep going down and down and down and down, what will happen to the balloon? You know this. Yeah, it's going to shrink because that added pressure adds to it, but that changes its density. Some divers don't realize this, and inexperienced divers. And at some point, you know how you naturally just think if you go underwater, you go down deeper and deeper. At some point, oh, I'm not going to make it. You just relax and you'll float back to the top because we naturally want to float because we're mostly less dense than the water. At some depth, the pressure increases so much that your density has changed. It can put enough pressure on you so that you're displacing less water. Your lungs won't be as full. Your body could be slightly smaller. And at some point, your overall density becomes greater than the water, at which case you continue to keep sinking. If you just relax after a certain depth, you won't just magically float to the top. You would keep sinking. If you want to do it afterwards or go home, just my favorite is just taking a balloon and trying to push it underwater. You can clearly feel the buoyant force becomes obvious. How hard you have to push on this. This is not deep enough to see it shrink any, but thinking of it again, if you went down 10 meters underwater, we learned that going down 10 meters would add a whole other atmosphere of pressure on you. So you'd be feeling two atmospheres of pressure, one from the water, one from the air. It'd be feeling twice the pressure, so it would clearly shrink then. I think it would be a measurable difference. All right. Two blocks of cement. They have the same volume. Put them in here. Cement can float or sink. But now, see, use your knowledge. What do you know about this one? It's what? It is lighter. How do you know that? This is lighter. These are both cement. How do you know it's lighter? It's not just because it's floating. You're right. I just want you to walk. Because they're the same volume.
And the same weight?
No, they aren't the same weight. They can't be the same amount of weight. If they had the same weight and the same volume, what else would they have the same? Density and position in the water. So which one is less dense? Yeah, this one, the one floating. So now you have enough tools to realize that, hey, this is floating. Boom, I know nothing about that, but if it's floating, then it is less dense than the water. It has to be. And this one's more dense than the water. It has to be because it's sunk. And you also know that which one. Now let's look at this one. How does the buoyant force on this compare to its weight? Is it moving up? Is it moving down? Want to re-answer? It's at this point neutrally buoyant. They're balanced. Or it would be going up or down. It's not rising. So in this position, the buoyant force is equal to its weight. How about this one? How does its buoyant force compare with its weight? The buoyant force is not enough. Its weight is larger. That's why it went to the bottom. It's too heavy for its volume, for its buoyant force. Which one, now this might, you might think of a trick question, which one is displacing more water? Good, the bottom, because it's completely submerged. So which one feels a larger buoyant force? Which one? Yes. Since this is displacing more water, it has a larger buoyant force on it. Now think of that. This one has a bigger buoyant force on it than this one. But this is the one floating. So it's not just how big the buoyant force is, it's how it compares to the weight. Right? If the buoyant force is, it's big here, but it's not enough, because this guy is a lot heavier. So these are just made differently. This one crammed more concrete in the same amount of space. This has more air in it. Same volume overall, but it's less dense, so it floats. And it doesn't go completely submerged. All right. Root beer and diet root beer. What do you know? More sugar in this one? Why does that make it sink? It makes it more dense. There's more mass in that pop can. So the same volume, but it's got more matter shoved in it, so it's more dense. And you know it's more dense than water because it sunk. This one's less dense than water because it's floating. It's almost submerged. The buoyant force on this one is greater than the buoyant force on this one, barely. So yeah, they don't use sugar in this one. They use a fake sugar that's sweeter, so you don't need as much of it. So yeah, there's less mass in here. It's less dense. Bowling ball. Yeah, it's real. Don't drop it because it hits the bottom and breaks. All right. Whoop. Most people think bowling balls sink. Well, that depends on what number you grab. Yeah.
On the buoyant force on the one that's sunk.
Uh-huh.
Is that has something to do with area? Because the one that's actually coming out of the water, if there's only part of it's in the water, so less buoyant.
That is absolutely correct, Patricia. This one, it's not completely submerged, so it's displacing less water, which means the buoyant force is not as large as the one that was on the bottom. But it's sufficient. The buoyant force, this is submerged enough until the buoyant force matches the weight. If I submerge it more, now the buoyant force has gone up, hasn't it? So it comes up until the buoyant force drops and balances the weight again. And that's what's happening with the bowling ball, too. The lighter bowling balls can float. The really big, heavy ones sink. Their densities are different. This one floats. A quick story. I was at Colorado State University, and they have a bowling alley in the Union. I like to go in there. There was a big flood, a 100-year flood, and they were in the basement. It flooded, and their number one problem, well, besides money and damage or whatever, was half their bowling balls disappeared because they floated and got washed downstream and they lost half their bowling balls, roughly half, because bowling balls can float. It's all about density. You know this because of a ship. We did that, right? You can have a huge aircraft carrier. It's heavy as all get out. But if you can spread that mass over a big enough volume, you can make its density less than water so it'll float. Its volume can displace enough water that the buoyant force can match the ship's weight. So if this weighed 10,000 tons, what would the buoyant force on it be for it to float? 10,000 tons. Boom, you're done. And if it's floating, you know its overall density must be less than water. How many of you went and floated in the Great Salt Lake ever? You guys done that? Some people aren't interested. You know, it is salty and you got all those brine shrimp. But I did it. It was cool, though. I walked out. You know, it's really shallow, of course. But I just kept walking and walking and walking and walking and walking. And eventually, all of a sudden, I'm not touching the bottom. I'm just whoop-de-doo. Why? Salty. Salt water is more dense than normal water. If it's more dense, the difference between my density and salt water is greater than my difference between my density and normal water. So yeah, I float easier. I displace more liquid, salt water, have a larger buoyant force, and you float out of it higher up. Feels fun, though. As long as you don't have any cuts and bruises, open wounds, you don't want that. Oh, good question. If our atmosphere, the air was twice as thick, doubled the density, yeah, effects. What was one you said?
We would feel lighter, but would it be harder to
light? Yeah, we'd feel lighter because that's like jumping into salt water instead of normal water. Since it's more dense, there'd be a bigger buoyant force on us. Yeah, we'd be a little lighter. But it's more dense. There's twice as much of it. So yes, it would be harder to move through. There'd be more air resistance. Be more conspicuous. There'd be more viscosity probably too because it's more dense. It'd be harder to move through. Exaggerating, it'd be like moving through molasses. You know, we're moving that way. So yeah, good observations. Any other questions or concerns on sinking and floating at this point? Yeah. Good. Throw it out there.
Hotter versus colder.
Ah. So the idea is hot air versus cold air. They are different. You noted what I noted or you read. I forget what you said. Hot air has more energy. We're going to get to that after chapter 14. It's hotter. They're moving around more. It's also, because it has more energy and they're jiggling around, they hit each other and spread out. So hot air is less dense than cold air. Boom. So what's it going to do? It rises. Hot air rises. You've heard that probably since you're hot air rises. Now you know why. Because it's less dense than cold air. Or the other way to look at it, because it takes up more space, because it's hot and jiggling, and so they spread out, they expand, it's displacing more of the surrounding air. It's bigger. So the buoyant force is larger. It goes up. Did that answer it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Oh, dang. There you go. Ice expands, I should say is more correct, water expands when it freezes. So yeah, you get water hot, it expands. When you get water cold, it contracts. If you have ice, when you get ice hotter, it'll expand. And when you get ice colder, it'll contract. But when it's near the phase change, when it changes phases, its density something different happens. And water is a special one. Most things, as they get colder and colder and colder and colder, they just keep getting smaller and smaller. Water actually expands for a bit when it turns into ice. And that changes its density. Ice floats in your soft drink, right? So ice, how does its density compare? You know, it's less dense than water. That's why it floats. So I never understood why we take straws and stick them in the bottom. Well, I do, but it's warmer down there. The ice is on the top. I often take my straw, move it up to the ice, so I'm drinking the cold fluid. unless it's been in there a while and had time to come to equilibrium. But. And ice also, icebergs, they float, right? They're huge and heavy, but you know the buoyant force balances the its weight. All of it isn't submerged. How much is submerged? Just enough to counter its weight. 90% of icebergs are underwater because they're heavy. They need to displace a lot of water. 10% is all we see up top. Good. Let's see. About 10 minutes. How are we doing? Oh, yeah. We've definitely covered all of 13. We're halfway through 14. I'm saving the when air starts to move, when fluids move for Friday. We'll do Bernoulli's principle and whatnot Friday. Let's see. Oh, yes, yes, yes. I have not done this. All right, so I've told you at this point that pressure is depth dependent. So it doesn't matter how much you have this way. It's just how deep you are below. In other words, the air over there isn't affecting me in that area, but the air above me is pushing on me. Force over an area, pressure. Buoyant force is a little different. I bet you can tell me already. Does buoyant force care how deep you are? Does it care how much space you take up? Yes. I'll do it after I explain this. Let me show you then. Let's just follow this. You can weight of the displaced fluid. All right. That is the mass of the displaced fluid times gravity. Newton's second law. So that's the mass of the displaced fluid. I'm going to write mass in terms of density. Density is mass over volume. So mass is density times volume. Just representing mass in terms of density again. We did that once before. So the mass of the displaced fluid, that's the density of the fluid. The volume of the displaced fluid times gravity. Some people, scientists, use this equation to guide their thinking for Archimedes' principle. I still remember it's buoyant force is equal to the weight of the displaced fluid. But when I got to calculate stuff, I look at this. This is the weight of the displaced fluid. And what does it depend upon? Well, it depends on the density of the fluid you're in because of this balance. If you're in salt water, the density is larger, you get more buoyant force. We discussed that. Gravity, makes sense. And volume. Buoyant force is not dependent upon depth. It doesn't care how far under you are. If you're under 10 meters, you're displacing. The ball. Here we go. All right, it's displacing a certain amount of water. Okay, now it's displacing more water, right? Is it displacing any more water now? Anywhere underwater, it's the same volume. Unless we go really, really deep. Right here, it's the same volume. If this is rigid, it can't shrink. It's displacing the same volume no matter where it's at, how deep it goes. Thus, it always feels the same buoyant force. This has the same buoyant force on it as this does. So buoyant force is not depth dependent. It's volume dependent. How much of the fluid's being displaced? Up here it doesn't displace as much, so the buoyant force goes down. Now it's displacing more, so the buoyant force goes up. So that's a nice thing to remember for you guys. Pressure is depth dependent. But buoyant force is volume dependent. And not just the volume of the object, but the volume of the displaced fluid. All All right. Let's do some more demos and apply this to air. All right, here's a hot water bottle. I'm just going to blow in it. Ta-da. The air comes out. I can exert a certain amount of pressure, you know, with my lungs. I can blow air in and cram it in, but I'm only so strong. Hey, Megan, will you help me? Just going to ask you to push down on this. And I want to see if I can do it. No, here, why don't you come on this side? They can probably see better. I couldn't do it. Okay. Let's spread it over a larger area. Pascal's principle. Same pressure, but I'm going to spread it over a larger area. That'll give me more what over there? Force. It's the same pressure here and there, but let's see if I can do it now. I tried it. I can't blow enough. I haven't spread it big enough for sitting. However, if I filled this full of water, I had a big thing of water, and I raised it up, all of this water would add pressure down here, and that could totally lift you. I've done that. I just didn't fill it with water today. Yes, thank you. So remember Pascal's principle. Again, you got the pressure is transmitted equally in an enclosed space, container. So the pressure I exert here is the same pressure as over here. But this is a small area, big area, so you can multiply the force. If you're trying to do what to them? They can't breathe. Oh, they're connecting the bag to their lungs. And they're increasing the pressure in the bag to force air into their lungs to expand it. That's like you blowing into a balloon to make it expand. No, I wouldn't put a board on this. This is the hydraulic press concept. The hovercraft we did, I was essentially doing this, where I was exerting a force over here, over this area, and I got a bigger force out over here, over this area, because the pressure is transmitted equally through here. That's what was this. Let's see, your case would be like your lungs trying to fill up a balloon, right? Oh, yeah, the other way around. So if these are deflated, right? Yeah, if you squeeze this, you increase the pressure. It's forced out of here, goes into here. So the pressure here is the same there. The pressure here, if it's enough, can expand the lungs. In some cases, though, if these are too small, it might not work. Let's see an example. When's it hardest to blow up a balloon? When it's deflated or after it's already inflated some? Yeah, deflated, right at the beginning. It's smaller. It requires more pressure. So if you can't exert that much pressure, it won't inflate. But it's because of the areas have to do with it. Once it's already partially inflated, it's a lot easier to keep inflating. So the hardest part with lungs for a newborn or somebody's that have deflated, you do need more pressure to inflate them initially. But yeah, this case, I don't see how to apply a board to this. But the idea is the area here and the area here are factors. But this can provide enough pressure to inflate lungs. If it didn't, we would revise this so we could exert more pressure. Because, yeah, we can't climb in here and put a board in to get more force inside your lungs. That would cause more damage, you know, believe it or not. How about one more volunteer? Who would like to feel this air pressure difference? Maybe we'll end with this one. It's fun. Doesn't hurt. And I can't do it myself. All right, come on down. So this is to emphasize again that the air does provide pressure. The atmosphere around us is significant. We just take it for granted. And it's only when we have differences in pressure that things happen, that we notice things. Just like that. If the pressure were the same in that case, it would never inflate the lungs. We have to increase the pressure on one side to inflate the lungs. Where a hydraulic press uses the same pressure, and just changes the area. All right, Candelario, we're going to ask you to climb inside the bag. So go ahead and step in there. Face your friends. Go ahead and pull it up as high as you can. All right, get down on your knees, please. Go ahead and get down on your knees, please.
Oh, that's going to be very hard.
Oh, is it hard to get on your knees?
I can't believe.
All right, we'll do it this way then. Go ahead and hold that. You want to squat slightly? I'll be. No. We want you to breathe. So, let's see. It's not quite as effective this way, but I'm going to try to seal it up slightly here.
Okay.
You'll still get the effect. I'm going to pull out some of the air from inside the bag. All right, raise your leg. Can you raise your leg? Can you go like this?
No.
It's just like sealing food, yeah. Thank you very much. Yeah, if we had you all the way up to your neck, I could seal it up more, and people can't even do anything. The idea here is we can review a couple things. All right, there's a difference in pressure from the inside to the outside. And the atmospheric pressure is acting on the outside. It's keeping her from being able to move as much. There's that difference in pressure. That difference in pressure is acting on all surfaces of the outside of the bag, which is a big surface. No offense, but she has a lot of surface area. We all do. And what's that do to the force? Pressure spread over a large area creates a lot of force. And if it's enough, we can restrict her movements. Her force can't overcome it. It's just like suction cups. Well, that's where I'll start next time. And then we'll start moving this fluid and show you how that changes pressure. Thanks.